So good afternoon, everybody, and I welcome you all on behalf of Multidisciplinary Committee AOGD and Dr. Anita Razoria. She is the Vice President of DZF Southwest, Chairperson of Adolescent Health Committee AOGD, and she is also the contestant for Medical Disorders of Pregnancy POCSI Committee this year. She will conduct the whole program. Over to Dr. Anita Razoria.
Thank you, Dr. Shashi, for this opportunity. Welcome my respected faculty and all my dear delegates. It's a great honor for me to conduct this webinar. We all know that thyroid disease is second only to diabetes mellitus as the most common endocrinopathy that happens in the reproductive age group of women. So that diagnosis is also very challenging because the thyroid disorders, they mimic the symptoms of pregnancy. So we have held this webinar, specially focused webinar, so that we can know how, we should have all the know-how to diagnose and how to manage these conditions in pregnancy regarding thyroid disorders. So our guest of honor, today's chief guest is Dr. Achala Batra. So Achala Batra ma'am is our president AOGD. She is head of the Department of Obs and Gyne at VMMC and Surgeon Hospital. Ma'am has been president NARCHI Delhi chapter between 2018-20, chairperson Urogyne committee, rural health committee, and she has had post of secretary AOGD also during 15-16. Ma'am has been editor also of AOGD and NARCHI bulletins, and she is coordinator to FOCSI Critical Care Conference and many other UBA FOCSI conferences. Ma'am is a very dedicated PG and UG teacher, conducted so many research products, author of so many workbook of obstetrics, and contributed various chapters to books. She has been a reviewer in various national journals and has contributed to several MOHFW guidelines regarding various medical disorders and all. So over to you, Dr. Achala ma'am, for your encouraging words.
Thank you, Anita. Thank you very much. And I'm very happy today that we have Dr. Jaideep Tank as a chairperson for your lecture of the thyroid by Deepak. And we have our special guest, the vibrant Jyoti Malik, whom I had to really persuade to be the special guest, because she thought that she did not deserve the honor, but I think she does. So, and this topic, thyroid, we've been having many times, but I think it really needs to be revised because we do tend to forget, and in every webinar we learn something new. And at least this is something, like Anita said, thyroid is so prevalent in our country, in Delhi. When we are seeing our ENC, at least 50-60% of the women have, maybe subclinical hypothyroidism, but they have, a high TSH. So what has to be done and what is required would be, we will learn in this webinar. And I'm sure we'll go home with very good take-home messages. And I once again welcome Dr. Jaideep and Dr. Jyoti Malik, who have agreed to grace the occasion. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Our guest of honor, another guest of honor, is Dr. Jyoti Malik. She is well known in Delhi NCR circle and all over the country. Dr. Jyoti Malik is MS of JJ Institute of Medical Sciences, Bahadurgarh. She is Director, Roots, IVF and Fertility Institute, JJIMS, Vice Chapter, Haryana Chapter of ISAR, Secretary, Haryana OBGYN, Joint Secretary. She has held so many positions, and she is APG Abdul Kalam Appreciation Awardee, Swasthya Ratan Award 2018, then Healthcare Excellence Award, so many to her credit. And she has many contributions in international and national journals.
Thank you, Dr. Rita. Thank you. We will save time here. Yeah, and sure. Thank you. I mean, it is actually a very, as Dr. Achala ma'am said, I had to be really nagged into to come over, because I think I didn't know what to do. आई मीन जैसे कि वो ऑस्कर मिलता है तो फिर आप स्पीच तैयार करते हो कि हाँ क्या बोलेंगे क्या नहीं. So for the last so many days, I was thinking कि let me speak like this, let me speak like that, because talk देना है तो ठीक है, we give a talk. In a panel, we know what we know, what we have to say. But being a guest and that too on a platform where we have such senior stalwarts and Jaideep sir and Achala ma'am and coming on to that platform as a guest is really an honor to me. And I really owe it to you, Achala ma'am. And Dr. Shashi, who has made this, it is like a dream come true for me, something like that. So thank you very, very much for this honor. And I really, really thank you all for this. And I congratulate AOGD, the Multidisciplinary Committee, and the DGF Southwest, who have brought this CME, where, as Dr. Anita said, it is the second common endocrine disorder in pregnancy, which leads on to so many complications during pregnancy. It leads on to miscarriage, abruptio, IUGRs and all. And by a simple test and by controlling our thyroid levels, we can save so many complications in that particular, we can make that turbulent pregnancy so very peaceful. So it is going to be a wonderful, wonderful session today where we would be overviewing the focusing especially on the emergencies, thyroid emergencies there with a very great endocrinologist, Dr. Deepak Khandelwal. I have heard many times, and the chairpersons are my two favorites. Dr. Surveen as chairperson, endocrinology committee, AOGD, my favorite. And Dr. Jaideep sir, ke liye to main, I have no words. I can speak for hours together. A wonderful person, a thorough clinician, a thorough academician, and a thorough magician. Whenever you listen to him, you like, when the talk finishes, you are like mesmerized at the end of the talk. So welcome, sir, on this platform. And after that, we have a wonderful, great panel discussion on A to Z of pregnancies with thyroid, where Dr. Shashi and Dr. Mala, the able moderators, they have chosen their pearls. They have chosen their eminent panelists, Dr. Suchitra, Dr. Khandelwal, Dr. Rakhi, Dr. Bharti, Dr. Mrinalini, Dr. Meenakshi, and Dr. Charu. So I'm sure at the end of these 2 hours of teaching and rigorous discussions, we are all going to be very, very benefited, all those who have joined. And thank you for this honor again, Achala ma'am, Dr. Shashi, and Dr. Anita. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Jyoti, for those encouraging words. Definitely, the thyroid disorders are so important that we had conducted a series of these, focused webinars on thyroid disorder in pregnancy. We had one on hypo, then hyper, and other thyroid emergencies also when I was reproductive endocrinology chairperson. So to carry that legacy forward, our dear Dr. Surveen Ghumman is also into that, and she has also conducted various webinars on thyroid disorders. It is so important that national guidelines are there for hypothyroidism in pregnancy, how to screen and all that. So we'll start our... to welcome our dear... respected Dr. Jaideep Tank, sir. Sir is secretary, sir has been secretary general, FOCSI 2018.
You are not audible.
You can't hear me? Hello?
Yes, yes, yes.
She's audible.
I think, you are
audible.
Okay. Yeah, okay, thank you for that. Sir has been secretary general, FOCSI 2018-21, project lead, FOCSI USA projects 2024, past president, MOG. Sir has been chair FIGO committee for safe abortion, deputy secretary AOFOG, and he has been awarded the honoris causa in 2020 by RCOG, and past chair publication and newsletter committee, past chair reproductive endocrinology and infertility committee of OCC. And I am really thankful to sir. He made me a part of this committee and gave me opportunity to go international. Thank you so much, sir, for that. Sir has been past chair MTP committee, FOCSI. He has so many awards and accolades to his credit. I'm really honored to welcome you, sir, here. Our another chairperson is none other than Professor Surveen Ghuman Sindhu. She is director and head IVF and Reproductive Medicine Center, MAX Multispeciality Hospital, Padparganj. And she is Professor, School of Health Sciences, Ansal University. Ma'am has more than 30 years of clinical experience. She has authored 8 books, 4 of which have been published internationally. And she has more than 80 publications in journals and books. She is a fellow in reproductive medicine, and she's running a fellowship program there. And she's assistant editor of Fertility Science and Research Journal, peer reviewer to so many journals. And she has held various positions in important academic societies and has numerous awards to her credit, like Foxy Norzonova Award, Distinguished Service Award by IMA, ET Award 2019, Best IVF Specialist, then Satya Paul IOG Award, IMT Summit Icon of the Year, so many to her credit. So welcome, Dr. Surveen. Stage is all yours. And over to you, Jaideep sir, to introduce the speaker of our scientific session, Dr. Deepak Khandelwal.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Anita ji, for those very, very kind words. It is indeed my pleasure and honor to be here in this program organized by the AOGD and the DGFSW. Multidisciplinary committee. Let me begin by thanking Anita ji, Dr. Achala Batra madam for inviting me here. And of course, it's always such a pleasure to meet and listen to Jyoti. Thank you, Jyoti, and Dr. Achala madam also for those very kind words. I have requested Dr. Surveen that I could start off the session, and Dr. Surveen will then introduce the speaker and also give a concluding remark at the end of his presentation. And of course, we are looking forward to hearing Dr. Deepak and then the panel, which is going to be moderated by Dr. Maheshwari, Dr. Sumitra, with experts like Dr. Deepak, Dr. Rakhi, Dr. Mala Madam, Dr. Bharti Joshi, Dr. Mani Madam, Dr. Meenakshi, and Dr. Charu. I'm not going to come in the way of what promises to be a excellent presentation on a very important topic, except to say that thyroid disease in pregnancy for me has always been some kind of a dilemma, primarily because the diagnosis is not made without serological investigations. And a lot of the symptoms of hypo as well as hyperthyroidism are sometimes mimicked by the presence of pregnancy itself. But one thing that has always taken me aback or has disturbed me to a certain extent is the lack of knowledge about thyroid disease in pregnancy. And I have sometimes seen patients who have been recommended a termination of pregnancy for a borderline high thyroid disease when I really don't think there is good enough evidence to support that. So I hope that we will learn more about these issues in the presentation and the panel to follow. And can I request Dr. Surveen to now please introduce the speaker? Thank you very much, Dr. Surveen.
Thank you, Dr. Jaideep. It's a pleasure having you on this platform. And at the outset, thank you, Dr. Shashi, Dr. Achada, for having me over. It's my pleasure to introduce our speaker today, Dr. Deepak Khandelwal, Senior Consultant, Endocrinology and Diabetes at Paschim Bihar. He's a postgraduate from AIIMS and has done his DM Endocrinology also from AIIMS. Treasurer Speed, more than 100 publications in various international and national journals. Principal investigator for more than 20 clinical trials in the field of diabetes and endocrinology, involved in teaching as well as thesis co-guide for DNB students. Dr. MMS Ahuja Award 2012 for the best DM endocrinology candidate at AIIMS. First prize in Torrent Young Scholar Award Endocrinology 2011 for the best DM endocrinology candidate. Osler Award for the best oral paper. Regularly invited as speaker in various national and international conferences and has delivered over 200 talks. I think we are going to have a very great detailed lecture from him on thyroid disorders. Over to you, Dr. Deepak.
Very good afternoon to everyone. Sincere thanks to AOGD committee, especially Dr. Sasilata, Dr. Anita Rajoria, Madam, Thanks, Dr. Surveen, for my kind introduction. I can see sort of, you know, I can say sort of authorities in the field of gynecology, you know, who are known by their names, like Dr. Asila Batra, Dr. Jadeep, I can see Dr. Jyoti Malik. So I think all are sort of very renowned figures. And, you know, for me also, it is sort of really honor to speak, you know, in front of such a sort of learned audience. So this is the topic given to me, overview of thyroid disease in pregnancy with a special focus on thyroid emergencies. So this is what I am going to speak because, you know, obviously the time allotted was 20 minutes. So I, you know, try to cover some aspect. Of course, you know, we cannot, as we all know, yes, we keep on talking about thyroid in pregnancy, but every time we try to learn one or, you know, sort of two points, you know, new, you know, from every webinar. Also, as you know, a lot of confusions still persist. Awareness sort of, you know, is still lot of unawareness at the level of patients, at the level of physicians, and as Dr. He was talking about, you know, like, you know, termination of pregnancy is being recommended. So I think there are some points that, you know, I would like to discuss here very briefly about thyroid physiology. Then I will focus primarily on hypothyroidism in pregnancy because I think that is one thing that, you know, primarily is managed at the level of gynecologist. I would like to, you know, sort of skip hyperthyroidism where, you know, I would still say, you know, the cases who require treatment, yes, and most of those patients, they will require referral to the level of endocrinologist. Then yes, as I have to talk about emergencies. There are only two thyroid emergencies. One is myxedema coma, that is extreme form of hypothyroidism. Another is thyrotoxic crisis, that is extreme form of hyperthyroidism. Now both emergencies, they are very rare. And if you talk about, you know, seeing these emergencies in pregnancy, let me tell you, I am yet to see any case of myxedema coma or thyrotoxic crisis presenting for the first time in pregnancy. So yes, as you know, most of you agree, and I think the comments, they have already come from most of you. Yes, thyroid disorders, they are one of the most common endocrine disorders found in pregnancy. I think they are the second commonest endocrine disorders after diabetes. The overt hypothyroidism, it can be seen in almost like 0.5% of pregnancies. But as you know, as Dr. Asila Batra was talking about subclinical hypothyroidism, now we have data as many as 10 to 15% of pregnancies, they can have subclinical hypothyroidism. Hyperthyroidism is relatively less common and it can be seen in 0.1 to 0.4% of pregnancies. And one thing is postpartum thyroiditis that presents after the delivery and primarily in women who are TPO positive. So you can see that, you know, it can present in almost 4 to 10% of women after the delivery. Now, when we start the discussion, I think physiology is very, very important. Again, these are sort of very, 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 very familiar slides to all of us. And I think most of these basic things we all know. But again, we tend to keep on making the simple mistakes in clinical practice. We all know TBC, that is thyroxine binding globulin, it increases in pregnancy because of the estrogen effect. Now, when the TBC is going to rise, your total T4 and total T3, they're going to increase. And total T4 and total T3, they increases by almost 50%. In a normal pregnancy as compared to the normal reference range. So if you have to, you know, compare total T4 and total T3 in pregnancy, you have to multiply non-pregnant reference range by 1.5. Like if the non-pregnant reference range for T4 is 6 to 10, then your pregnancy reference range for T4 will become 9 to 15. 6, you have to multiply by 1.5, it becomes 9. Similarly, 10, you have to multiply by 1.5, that becomes 15. So your total T4 and total T3, they will become 1.5 times of known pregnant reference range in pregnancy. On the contrary, 3T4 and 3T3, they are more or less maintained within the known pregnant reference range. Of course, we all know that in the first trimester, because of the SCG effect, you can have decrease in TSH values and slight increase in the FT4 values. And some of these women, they can present with so-called gestational thyrotoxicosis in the first trimester of pregnancy, that is primarily because of the SCG effect, and it spontaneously becomes normal as the pregnancy advances, goes into the second and third trimester. And this gestational thyrotoxicosis per se does not require any treatment with antithyroid medications. So as I was discussing total T4 and total T3, you have to compare in pregnancy by multiplying known pregnant reference range by 1.5. So there becomes almost 1.5 fold of non-pregnant reference range. FT4 and FT3, yes, we can understand now there are some labs which have already started providing pregnancy-specific reference range. You can see some of the labs, first trimester aptitude, you know, reference in second trimester aptitude, aptitude reference senses. But most of the labs, unfortunately, they are still not doing so. And you know, if that reference sense is not available, and if you are checking for aptitude and aptitude, you can generally rely on non-pregnant reference sense in that particular scenario. So, but I think a lot of caution is required, because you know, aptitude and aptitude assays, they are more challenging, you know, as far as these assays they are to be done, and ideally they should need to be done by equilibrium dialysis. As already discussed, yes, maternal hypothyroidism is much more common than what we, you know, generally used to believe in the past. And if you see the latest studies, of course, it depends on the kind of TSH cutoff that you are taking for the first or second trimester. But latest studies, they are suggesting that almost 10 to 15% of women, they can have mild degree of subclinical hypothyroidism in pregnancy. Again, I think a lot of comments, they came from Dr. Jyoti Malik, everyone, that yes, hypothyroidism in pregnancy is associated with some negative outcomes, whether for the mother or for the fetus, like higher risk of miscarriage, gestational hypertension, preterm delivery, anemia, postpartum hemorrhage, and fetal complications. So I think these are some of the complications. And this is one of the landmark study. And I think, you know, I would like to actually highlight this study. This is one of the study published in New England Journal of Medicine in 1999. And I think this is done sort of, you know, because this is the only study, you know, from where we can have sort of, you know, data regarding neurodevelopmental outcome of a child in a case of untreated hypothyroidism in mother. Because, you know, that point of time, like in 90s or 1992, universal screening for thyroid was not being recommended. So what was done in this particular study? This study was published in 1999. So what they did, because, you know, in US, they have samples, you know, frozen in the deep freezers, like, you know, the samples they were taken in the time of pregnancy. That point of time, they keep those samples in the deep freezer. Now you want to take out those samples after 7 years, 9 years, you can take out those samples, and whatever assays you want to run, like TSH or T4, you can get it done at that point of time. So how they planned this study, because in these women, the thyroid function test was not done at the time of pregnancy because there were no symptoms. And the universal screening was not recommended at that point of time. So what they did, now these women, they had delivered like 7 or 9 years back, their children, they are already now 7 to 9 years old. So what they did, they actually took out those samples which are, you know, placed in the deep freezers 7 or 9 years back at the time of pregnancy of these women. And now they checked for T4 and TSH levels. At the same time, they also looked into the children who are already like 7 to 9 years of old, and tried to look into their intelligence levels, other issues like attention, language, reading ability, school performance, etc. So what they found, the mother who had untreated hypothyroidism in pregnancy that point of time, which was not treated, and when their children, they are already between 7 to 9 years of old age, these children, they had IQ which was 7 points less as compared to children who were born to euthyroid mother. So I think this is very interesting data. Of course, this is not interventional data, this is retrospective observational data, but I think very important information. The ladies who has untreated hypothyroidism in pregnancy, they were not treated, they had delivered children, they are already like 7 to 9 years old. Now these children, they had IQ which was 7 points less as compared to children who were born out of euthyroid mothers. So of course, you know, when you look into this 7 point IQ, it may not sound, you know, too much, because it was like 106 mean IQ in control as compared to 99 in untreated mothers. So, but I think in today's era where, you know, parents, they're looking for a single child, you know, they want their children to be super smart, I think this IQ also can matter a lot. So this is another sort of, you know, systematic review and meta-analysis which is published in context of subclinical hypothyroidism. Absolutely no doubt that I think we have discussed. Yes, subclinical hypothyroidism in pregnancy is associated with multiple adverse maternal and neonatal outcomes like high risk of pregnancy loss, placental abruption, and all these things. But the interventional data, like, you know, if we treat these mothers and then translating into benefits, the interventional data is actually very, very limited. So we have observational data which is clearly showing, yes, subclinical hypothyroidism may not be good, but treating subclinical hypothyroidism and translating into benefit, this kind of data as of now is very, very limited. But I think from observational data, we will try to infer, yes, most of these women who have subclinical hypothyroidism in pregnancy, they should be treated. Now, I think you all of you will remember very well, like, you know, whenever I was going to any CMAs before 2017, you know, any gynae forum, that point of time, you know, we always used to talk about TSS less than 2.5 in the first trimester, and less than 3 in the second and third trimester. And all women who used to have TSS more than 2.5 in the first trimester and more than 3 in the second and third trimester. As per the guidelines, they were, you know, recommended to be treated with levothyroxine. Then eventually it was realized then that lots of these women, they were actually sort of, you know, being over-treated or unnecessarily treated without any clear evidence of benefit. So that ATA or American Thyroid Association 2017 guidelines, they were modified and they started talking about population specific reference range for TSS in a pregnancy. Like for India or for Northern India or for Delhi, we should have reference range for normal pregnant women in our own population. However, this data may be available to some countries, this data may not be available to some countries. Like for India, we, as of now, we have very limited data, but I think it is more or less matching what is, you know, being shown at least in other Asian countries like China or Japan. So these guidelines, they're also clearly mentioning in the absence of such data, the upper limit of 4 can be taken for a normal TSS in pregnancy. So yes, if you have a pregnancy specific normal reference range for our own population, that is the best. In the absence of such data, the upper limit of TSS of 4 can be taken for sort of normal reference range for pregnancy in most of the population. And I think that is what now most of the, you know, endocrinologists, they have already started following in clinical practice. Now, as per these guidelines, suppose there's a woman coming for the first time in pregnancy, so the TSS is coming as more than 4, then yes, it is clearly subclinical hypothyroidism and these women, they require treatment. If the TSS is less than 2.5 in the first trimester, no further investigations and no treatment. As per these guidelines, if the TSS is between 2.5 to 4 in the first trimester, then ideally you must check for TPO antibody. And if the TPO antibody is positive, these women, they require treatment. The women who have TSS between 2.5 to 4 and the TPO antibody is negative, you need not treat and no further follow-up is required. So I think these guidelines, they have given sort of a lot of clearance. And as per these guidelines, I think I would say a lot of women, you know, whenever, even in the first trimester, the TSS was coming as 3.1 or 3.2, even if the TPO was negative, as per the previous guidelines, we were actually treating those women and probably they were sort of, I would say, over-treated or unnecessarily treated. So yes, when they have TPO positivity, yes, there's a clear evidence they have much higher risk of going into overt hypothyroidism. And these women, if they have TSS more than 2.5 in the presence of antibody positivity, they require treatment. And again, you need to follow these women every 4 to 6 weeks. So as per these guidelines, the TSS more than 4 or more than the upper limit of reference range for pregnancy, you need to treat. In these women, you need not check for TPO antibody. If the TSS is less than 2.5, no treatment, no antibody, no further follow-up. Between 2.5 to 4, you check for TPO antibody, and if you treat, if the TPO antibody is positive. So I think these are sort of recommendations from American Thyroid Association 2017 guidelines, and this is what I have already started following in my own clinical practice. As per these guidelines, if there's any pregnancy with assisted reproductive technique, whether it is IUI pregnancy or IVF pregnancy or whatever, if the TSH is more than 2.5, even in the absence of TPO negativity, you must treat with levothyroxine. So I repeat, any pregnancy with assisted reproductive technique, whether it is IUI, IVF, whatever, TSH is more than 5, even if the TPO is negative, you need to treat these women because there's some evidence, yes, in these women, if you treat with levothyroxine, there's some evidence of benefit or some decrease in complications like preterm delivery or miscarriage. So I think some controversy regarding a lot of women with TPO positivity and TSS less than 2.5. So there are some papers like, you know, the risk of, if they have a history of recurrent miscarriage in the past, then some of these women you can treat with low dose of levothyroxine. So TPO positivity and TSS less than 2.5, the data is plus minus, there are some studies. And if they have history of recurrent miscarriage and you want to treat these women with low dose of levothyroxine to prevent recurrent miscarriage, that can be one of the justification. So just to summarize whatever I have talked till now, yes, we need to screen all women in the first trimester. If the TSS is less than 2.5, no further evaluation, no treatment. If the TSS is between 2.5 to 4, we need to check for TPO antibody. And if the TPO antibody is positive, we need to treat. If the TSS is more than 4, treat and TPO antibody need not be checked. If the pregnancy is by assisted reproductive technique, even if the, you know, any TSS more than 2.5, we need to treat, even if they are TPO negative. And of course, once we take a decision to treat, then the target TSS is less than 2.5 in the first trimester and less than 3 in the second and third trimester. So of course, the target TSS is, I am talking about when we have already taken a decision to treat. Sometimes on a value of TSS 3.7, you may decide not to treat, that is absolutely okay. But once you have taken a decision to treat, then these are your target TSS in the first trimester or in the second or third trimester respectively. As I think Dr. Jaydeep sir was talking about a lot of unawareness, also at the level of physicians, this is one of the study as part of our society, our speed group, society for promotion of education in endocrinology and diabetes. So this study we did from New Delhi, in one of our thyroid conference. So we did questionnaire-based survey of general physicians, general practitioners, and most of these surveys, they were answered by general physicians, more than 200. So we just looked into their routine clinical practice, what they are doing into their routine clinical practice to manage primary hypothyroidism, in their day-to-day practice. As sir was talking about, let me tell you, almost 250% of physicians, the TSS targets in pregnancy, they were not clear. So I'm not, criticizing anyone, but I think still, in spite of so many meetings, in spite of so many, education platforms, yes, still there are gaps in our understanding regarding thyroid disorders, especially at the level of GPs and general physicians. And of course, it is all of our duty, to make more and more awareness at every level, whether it is at the level of gynecologist or at the level of physicians. This is one of the study, we published from our own center, prevalence of hypothyroidism and thyroid autoimmunity in PCOS girls. So, what we found, because, some of these patients with metabolic syndrome, PCOD, they have much higher risk of developing thyroid autoimmunity or subclinical hypothyroidism. So in this particular study, what we demonstrated, mean serum TSS was significantly higher in PCOS girls as compared to age-matched controls. Also numerically higher percentage of girls with PCOS, they had subclinical hypothyroidism and TPO positivity, but this was not statistically significant. So this study we published, I think 1 year back in Thyroid Research and Practice Journal. Now I think there was one important thing. So, genuine thyroid emergencies like mixed edema coma in pregnancy, maybe I would say very, very rare, but yes, this is one common scenario where, I'm sure all of us have encountered in our practice. And I can remember, 3 days, I think some 1 week on back only, we were doing one of the thyroid meeting. Dr. Anita Rajoria was there. There was a lot of discussion about this topic. So just to give you insight here, this is a 26-year-old lady, 8 weeks pregnancy, no paucity of thyroid illness, and the thyroid was checked in the pregnancy for the first time, very low FT4 and TSS 150. So I think this is a scenario, as gynecologist, I'm sure all of you must have encountered in your clinical practice. Now, whether it is severe hypothyroidism coming for the first time in pregnancy, whether we need to advise for medical termination of pregnancy, I think that is really a question. So overt hypothyroidism diagnosed during pregnancy, should we advise medical termination of pregnancy, or should we simply put the patient on high dose of levothyroxine and just prepare for optimal fetal and long-term neuropsychological outcome in the child? Let me tell you, all guidelines, they're absolutely silent over this issue. No guidelines, they actually discuss this issue. In none of the review article or any guidelines, there's no clear mention whether you need to go for medical termination of pregnancy or whether you should just continue pregnancy. In fact, there are no randomized controlled trials, no consensus guidelines to answer this challenging question. So I remember, almost 8 or 9 years back, because, me and one of my close friend, Dr. Sameer Agarwal from Rohtak, I think Dr. Rajoria and Dr. Ishwati Malik knew him very well. So we, there was one of the doctor couple, who came to me also and Dr. Sameer also, and again, they were just discussing, and they were like, you have to take the decision whether we want to continue pregnancy or not. So we just, because no clear mention on guidelines, no textbooks talks about it. So we just put this question to, we just identified 4 authorities in the world who are sort of, most renowned persons in the field of thyroid and pregnancy, who have done most of the research in this field. So one, this is from Rosa Niesenberg, again, sort of, I would say very renowned person in the field. So sometimes they simply write, we just send complete case details. Sometimes they reply only in one line. So her answer was, I wouldn't advise to terminate the pregnancy. That was the first answer that we got. This is answer from De Negro, again, the person who has done a lot of research in thyroid and pregnancy. In fact, one of the landmark paper in TPO positive women with normal TSH less than 2.5 has actually come from De Negro. So De Negro reply was, you should not advise to stop pregnancy. This is, you know, De Groot, and, you know, I would say sort of father in endocrinology. They are sort of, you know, very heavy textbooks which are coming with the name of De Groot. His reply was, you should discuss the possible adverse effects of maternal hypothyroidism with the patient. However, our guidelines does not advise for or against termination. And this is the last reply, again, from a very, very authority person. You know, I think he's already 90 years of age, Leonard Bartowski, very, very experienced person in the field of thyroid. His reply was, and I think it is, I would say, one of the most important reply, a very difficult decision. But if it were my wife or daughter, and she was otherwise fertile and capable of more pregnancies, yes, I would recommend termination. But if it is someone who has had great difficulty in conceiving and is willing to take the chance of possible congenital abnormalities, then one could treat now with thyroxine vigorously and do ultrasound to assess fetal structures. And if normal, let the pregnancy continue. But there's no right or wrong answer. So I think that this was the reply from him. So the present consensus is against recommending abortion. You know, as you know, treating physicians, we cannot recommend for medical termination of pregnancy. But despite thyroxine, we cannot fully reassure, you know, about potential brain damage. So I always mention on my prescription that, you know, a risk of severe hypothyroidism in pregnancy is clearly, you know, for mother and fetus, it is discussed with the patient and the family. So I think this is what, you know, I'm sure all of us, they are following in clinical practice. Of course, if the pregnancy is more than 20 weeks, there's no point in discussing about MTP. If it is subclinical or, you know, mild hypothyroidism, definitely, yes, we have to simply continue those pregnancies. But if it is severe hypothyroidism, then we have to simply explain each and everything to the patient and let the family decide. So we have to simply tell them, yes, there's some risk. Data in the literature is very, very limited. And this is primarily your call, because as doctors, we cannot recommend for MTP, but as patients, you can always take a decision for MTP. In my practice of 10 years, I have almost seen, I would say almost 125 or 150 patients with TSH more than 50 or 70, you know, coming for the first time in pregnancy in the first trimester. Fortunately, almost everyone has taken decision to continue the pregnancy. And many of these women, they were delivered like 4 years back, 7 years back. Their children, they are also coming for follow-up. And these ladies, they are now coming for follow-up. Most of these children, they are doing very well. I've never seen any sort of major issues, you know, in children born out of these mothers. I remember two of my patients, you know, willingly, they took the decision herself to get the pregnancy terminated, because sometimes they have their reasons, like we are married for 4 months, we never planned for it, you know, and we are very young. We simply want to delay it, and, you know, we can plan it later on. So two of my patients, they, you know, on their own, they have taken the decision for MTP. All others, they have continued the pregnancy. Fortunately, as of now, I have never seen any major issues, you know, in children born out of these mothers. But I think as because sometimes we never, you know, coincidentally also sometimes there may be issues, you know, in children. So as, you know, as treating physicians, as treating gynecologists, as medically equally important also, we must document in our prescriptions, yes, we have discussed the possible consequences on mother and fetus, you know, out of these pregnancies. Of course, once we take a decision to treat, we have to normalize TFTs as rapidly as possible. And sometimes we would like to give little higher dose also in pregnancies. As I was discussing, you know, once we decide to treat, the target TSH in the first trimester is less than 2.5. The target TSH in the second and third trimester is less than 3. And of course, in pregnancy, we require much frequent follow-up. So I typically follow these women on a monthly basis or 4 weekly basis. So every 4 weeks we check their TFTs, and, you know, we try to target TSH strictly within the so-called target range. So yes, some of these women, they are coming to us, you know, preconceptionally also. That point of time, we have to optimize their TSH. A lot of these women, they are already hypothyroid, already on thyroxine, TSH is okay. As soon as they come to us with confirmed pregnancy, we have to increase the dose, because in pregnancy, the dose increased by almost 30 to 50%. So suppose if they are taking 75 microgram of levothyroxine and TSH is still okay, TSH is still 2.2, I would like to increase it to something like 100 microgram daily. So some increase in doses is actually required as soon as the pregnancy is confirmed. These are your target TSH that I have already discussed. And once they deliver, I again decrease the dose by almost by 50% or to the pre-pregnancy dose. And then check TSH 6 to 8 weeks post-delivery. And I think I've already discussed, yes, subclinical hypothyroidism in pregnancy definitely requires treatment. Now, I think a lot of these women, almost all of these women, they are taking iron and calcium also in pregnancy. So I think one of the important thing that we have to tell them, because if they take iron and calcium within 4 to 6 hours of taking levothyroxine, then the complete absorption may not occur. So they have to make gap of at least 4 to 6 hours between thyroxine and iron and calcium tablets. I don't know how much time I have left, or you know, you can just tell me.
I think your time is finished, Dr. Deepak.
Okay, fine.
Dr. Deepak, you continue.
I will try to summarize in maybe next 5 minutes. So yes, after delivery, again, we have to decrease the dose. So I was, you know, given the responsibility to talk on mixed edema, coma, or thyroid emergency. But let me tell you, they are very, very rare emergencies. Mixed edema coma is extreme form of severe hypothyroidism, where patients, they can present with decompensated state in the ICU, with hypotension, with altered sensorium, with hypothermia, with severe bradycardia, and the treatment, you have to hospitalize the patient. These emergencies, they are associated with high mortality. Both mixed edema coma and thyrotoxic crisis, if you do not treat vigorously, the mortality rate is almost like 25 to 40%. So you have to treat, you know, sort of very rigorously these patients. You have to admit them into the ICU. Thyroid hormone replacement is, yes, it is required, and more important than that is the symptomatic supportive treatment. A lot of these patients, they require ventilatory support. You have to give like IV corticosteroids in most of these patients. If they have associated infections, you have to give IV antibiotics. So it is requires multidisciplinary approach, and you have to, you know, give them levothyroxine and all supportive care. So mixed edema coma is a rare disease. I'm not talking about pregnancy, but in my practice, I see something like only 2 or 3 cases in a year. That's all, not more than that. So in a 300 bedded hospital, you will see like 1 or 2 patients being hospitalized with mixed edema coma in 1 year, not more than that. And I've never seen any case of mixed edema coma in pregnancy. And I was just looking into the PubMed also. There's only single report of mixed edema coma in pregnancy published from Turkey in 2004. And that patient presented almost near term because he was not taking a levothyroxine. And it was almost mimicking like preeclampsia and eclamptic coma in that particular woman. So recently, you know, I think in last winters, we had one very difficult case of mixed edema coma in a young adult with Down syndrome. He came with severe hypothyroidism, gross anasarca, gross ascites, pericardial effusion, required ventilatory support for 3 weeks, required tracheostomy. For this young adult, we gave IV levothyroxine for 1 week, then oral levothyroxine, all symptomatic and supportive care. He was there into the ICU for almost 5 weeks, and finally we were able to discharge him, and he's now coming to me for follow-up, now doing absolutely okay. So this is a emergency which is extremely rare, but I think what we more commonly see in practice is severe form of hypothyroidism. I was talking about TSS more than 150. So this is the last paper that I will show here. So, you know, because we were seeing a lot of patients with TSS like 80 or 100, and the literature is very, very limited. So this is one of the study we published in 2019 from, you know, from Maharaja Krishna Hospital, Punjabi Vibhag, where I was previously associated. So we looked into thyroid symptomatology across the spectrum of hypothyroidism and impact of levothyroxine supplementation in patients with severe primary hypothyroidism. So we looked into patients who have TSS at least 40 in this particular study. So what we found, these patients who have severe hypothyroidism, they are more likely to be symptomatic, whatever their symptoms like fatigue or hair loss or whatever. I think what was really important, and one of the important messages that I would like to highlight here, because their mean TSS, you know, these 50 patients who had pre and post follow-up of severe hypothyroidism, mean TSS was 140, very, very high, more than 100. And after 12 weeks of levothyroxine supplementation, it becomes 3.81, almost euthyroid range. So in these patients, you know, when we looked into the change in the body weight, at baseline, it was 71.3 and it becomes 68.45. So I think what was really important, that in spite of such a severe hypothyroid state, when you treat them with levothyroxine, the decrease in body weight was only to the tune of 3 kilograms. Because a lot of people do think, you know, when the TSS is like 80 or 100, your body weight can increase by 10 kg, 15 kg or 20 kg. That is actually not true. Hypothyroidism does not cause morbid obesity, and weight gain even in severe hypothyroidism is less than 5 kilograms. So I think these things I would like to, so what is, you know, conclude here? Yes, thyroid diseases, they are common in pregnancy. it is very important to understand physiology to interpret the thyroid function test in pregnancy. Yes, hypothyroidism is associated with adverse pregnancy outcomes, and we have to treat that. And thyroid emergencies, they are actually rare. So thank you very much. And willingly, I did not cover hyperthyroidism because I think that was really not possible in 20 minutes. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Khandelwal. I think that was a very, very exhaustive review of hypothyroidism in pregnancy, and especially the myxedema part which you covered. I think for us obstetricians, it is a dilemma because a lot of symptoms of pregnancy overlap with symptoms of hypothyroidism like lethargy, constipation. And even testing for hypothyroidism, we know that the thyroglobin hormone increases, so the free testosterone decreases, total increases. So the obstetrician is left in a dilemma interpreting these results as such. And also the iodine uptake increases because of increased loss from the kidneys as well as increased demand from the thyroid. And taking all these into consideration, including the part that where the fetus is not producing the thyroid hormone and is totally dependent on the mother in the first trimester. And the mother's thyroid hormone starts becoming very important in the first trimester for us. So very nicely you've highlighted what are the levels which we require. There is a slight controversy on the ATA guidelines where they've said that yes, 4 is acceptable. FOXI came out with guidelines, I think Dr. Jaideep would know, in 2019, where they said that we're going to take a cutoff of 2.5, but they said that yes, if TPO antibodies are negative, consider treating, but it is not essential to treat. So these are very, very slight differences which are there. And in the Indian scenario, I think we are still treating at more than 2.5. I'd like Dr. Jaideep's comments on that.
Thank you very much, Dr. Surveen. Thank you very much, Dr. Deepak. That was an excellent presentation. I must say that the slides, particularly those you showed of your summary, was quite important. And it might really be a good idea to take a screenshot of those slides and keep them with you to recapitulate in a sense, you know, what one needs to do. I agree, Dr. Surveen, that there are differences in guidelines. And I think that is perhaps either resource specific or depending on which references the guidelines have alluded to. I think the long and the short really is that hypothyroidism is indeed a problem. And hypothyroidism should be looked for and treated aggressively if it is found in pregnancy. And one really shouldn't be in a hurry to recommend termination of pregnancy. And if one is recommending termination, it might be a good idea to do a consultation with an endocrinologist before advising so. Thank you very much again, Dr. Deepak. That was an excellent presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak, Dr. Jaideep, sir, and Dr. Surveen. Ashla, ma'am, will you like to add something to that or can we move ahead?
No, I would just like to add that if you really are thinking that these presentations should be saved, we have our AOGD YouTube, which this webinar would go, so anybody can refer back to that whenever required. It's a very nice presentation. Congratulations, Deepak.
Thank you, madam.
Thank you, everyone. So we move ahead towards the next part of our academic session. It is a panel discussion on these thyroid diseases. So the moderator for this great panel is Dr. Shashilata Kabra. Dr. Shashilata Kabra is, you know, the convener of this webinar. She is President DGF Southwest. And she is chairperson of multidisciplinary committee AOGD. She's NB faculty recipient of Wonder Foxy Award, APJ Abdul Kalam Appreciation Award, Karamveer, and so many to her credit. And she has conducted more than 50 workshops on PPH. And she's a very fine academician. And she will be conducting the panel today along with Dr. Sumitra Bachani. Dr. Sumitra is associate professor and senior specialist. She is faculty fetal medicine and genetic clinic, Safdarjung Hospital. She's also an ME teacher, nodal officer, COVID facility. Then she's member of various committee, joint secretary, AOGD in 2015-16. Then she has been web editor also. She also has many honors like fellow of maternal fetal medicine, RCOG, associate, etc., and has been awarded gold medal for her various research papers. And she has got, DOI citations for relief work in Jammu Kashmir and for being a COVID facility, co-investigator WHO and ICMR projects. So the panelists are going to be Dr. Deepak Khandelwal, who has already been introduced.
Still on,
welcome, Dr. Deepak, once again. Dr. Rakhi Dhawan Singh, has she joined? Dr. Shashi?
Dr. Anita, she has shown her inability to join today. Okay. She's tied up with something else.
Okay. Then next panelist is Dr. Mala Srivastava. She is senior consultant and professor GRIPMA, gynae endoscopic and robotic surgeon. She has been past president AOGD 2021. Her main areas of interest are gynae oncology, minimal access surgery. She has been also given ABG Abdul Kalam Excellence Award by DGF. She is currently ICOG governing council member, also zonal chairperson of ISOPARC. And she has held various important positions in societies like AOGD, ISCCP, NARCI, etc. Then Dr. Bharti Joshi, she's assistant professor OBGYN at PGIM Chandigarh. Welcome, Dr. Bharti. She got first order award as silver medal for MD PGIM Chandigarh. Research publications and more than 35 publications are to her credit. She's a recognized reviewer of many PubMed Index journals and has been faculty at various national conferences. Dr. Mrinalini Mani, she's past president DGF Southwest, and she's a FOCSI committee member of Breast and Family Welfare, very active member. She's a member of Multidisciplinary Committee, OGD, and Breast and Cervical Cancer Awareness Screening Prevention Committee also, executive member AOGD NARCHI, then Mission Pink Health, and she is a National Assessor of Quality and Mentor Lakshya Program GOI AIMS team, and she is Delhi State Committee member for COVID surveillance of acute adverse reaction following immunization regarding COVID vaccination. She has also so many other credentials, and she's faculty MB, so on and so forth. She's an APJ Abdul Kalam Excellence Awardee also, Wonder Foxen Award, and so many other to her credit, like Sankal Champion, etc. Welcome, Dr. Mrinalini. Then Dr. Meenakshi, I think she has also...
She's also not joining today.
Then Dr. Charu Sharma. She's Associate Professor, Department of OBGYN at AIMS, Jodhpur. Her main area of interest are fetal medicine, diagnostic and therapeutic interventions, then high-risk pregnancy, major achievements, research in more than 40 international and national journal publications are there to her credit. She has been awarded Fellowship of Indian College of Obs and Gynae, FMAS, awarded short-term training certificate in fetal medicine from AIMS, New Delhi. She has won gold medal, CS Dawn gold medal for best paper presentation at UPCOG, and so many other awards to her credit are there. So over to you, Dr. Shashi. I'll stop sharing this.
Thank you, Dr. Anita, for such a kind introduction. So straightway, we are moving to our panel. Am I audible?
Yes.
So good afternoon all. So today we will discuss A to Z of pregnancy with thyroid disease. Our expert is Dr. Deepak Khandelwal. So The aim of today's panel is to reduce maternal morbidity and serious complications during pregnancy and childbirth. And the objective is to reduce maternal, fetal, neonatal complications associated with hypothyroidism by screening pregnant women at risk for hypothyroidism. To reduce the burden of complications due to hypothyroidism during pregnancy through early diagnosis and treatment. This is very, very important. So, primary maternal hypothyroidism is defined as the presence of elevated thyroid stimulating hormone levels during pregnancy. Positive thyroid antibody titers suggest autoimmune thyroid disease. Euthyroid patients with positive thyroid peroxidase antibody titers have high chances of developing hypothyroidism. The fetus is dependent on maternal transplacental thyroid hormone supply in the first trimester. This, along with other factors, leads to an increased thyroid hormone demand during pregnancy. To meet the increased demand, the thyroid hormone production increases by 50%. Now, the Indian scenario is this, that India is known to be a relatively iodine sufficient belt. But however, iodine deficiency is still prevalent in certain pockets like the hilly regions and foothills. Moreover, moreover, iron deficiency is common in India, and this also contributes to hypothyroidism. Autoimmune thyroiditis contributes significantly towards hypothyroidism in iodine sufficient regions and maybe associated with other autoimmune disorders. Prevalence of hypothyroidism in pregnancy with Indian population is 4.8 to 12%. Some have reported 6 to 7%, and another Indian study has reported 12%. Dr. Deepak Khandelwal has mentioned that at some places it has reached up to 19%. TPO antibodies are positive in around 50% pregnant women in subclinical hypothyroidism as compared to 7% in euthyroid pregnant women. So my first question goes to Dr. Bharti. Dr. Bharti, you please let us know, how do thyroid function tests change during pregnancy?
Yes, good afternoon, everyone. As we do understand, in pregnancy, there is an increased metabolic demand, right? And there are the hormonal changes. So in terms of increased HCG, as well as increased estrogen and increased metabolic demands, there are few thyroid changes that has been noticed in the pregnancy. The first thing is because HCG has a thyrotropic action, so it causes increased production of T4 and T3, which results in decreased production of TSH. So one observation in pregnancy is that TSH level goes down, and in pregnancy trimester specific also, they are lower than the non-pregnant woman. Second thing is, because there is an increased production of T4 and T3, so therefore, and there is an increased production of sex hormone binding globulins also, thyroglobulin binding globulin also. So all of these causing increased level of total T4 and T3. Regarding free T4 level, there is a evidence that some say there is a transient decrease in first trimester and then it comes to normal, but it is said to be nearly normal in all the pregnancies trimester. So the interpretation remains that TSH goes down, total T4 and T3 increases, and the free T4 level almost stays near normal.
Thank you, Dr. Bharti. So the healthy thyroid adapts to these alterations through changes in thyroid hormone metabolism, iodine uptake. You have covered everything so nicely through the regulation of hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis, and thyroid function tests of healthy pregnant women therefore differ from those of healthy non-pregnant women. Over to Dr. Sumitra for the second question.
Thank you. The question was for Dr. Meenakshi. Dr. Meenakshi wasn't able to join us. So it is actually a question on thyroid physiology in normal women as well as in pregnant women. So would any panelists like to take this question? Any other panelists?
Dr. Deepak, an answer.
I think, ma'am, we were already, I was discussing this in my talk also, because I think, yes, this is the normal thyroid gland that you have shown. And I think it is important to understand hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis. So we all know there's a TRH at the level of hypothalamus that activates, you know, sort of pituitary to release TSH. And this TSH now activate your thyroid gland to release thyroid hormones. Now, what happens in normal pregnancy, I think it was already told that yes, there's an increase in metabolic demand because of estrogen effect, there's an increase in DVG, and also there's an increase in renal iodine excretion as well. So the iodine requirement also increases in normal pregnancy. I was discussing that total T4 and total T3, they becomes higher in pregnancy and they becomes almost 1.5 times of normal reference, normal known pregnant reference range in pregnancy. The free T4 and free T3, they are more or less like known pregnant reference range, except in the first trimester, you can see slight increase in FT4 because of SCG effect. And because of SCG effect also, you see some decrease in TSS in the first trimester that tends to come to sort of normal in the second and third trimester. Because of exchange effect in some of these women, you can evidence subclinical thyrotoxicosis also in like 5% of these women, which is, can be so-called gestational thyrotoxicosis. Yes, fetal thyroid physiology is also very, very important. And for the initial 7 to 9 weeks of gestation, absolutely no production of thyroid hormone by the fetus. So in the almost, in the, you know, I can say in the first trimester, the fetus is primarily dependent on maternal thyroid hormone for the normal brain and normal growth of fetus. So that is very, very important. That's why in severe primary hypothyroidism in the first trimester, there can be concerns for neurocognitive decline in the child, because in the brain is actively developing in the first trimester. But for the initial 11 weeks, fetus is not making you know, on any thyroxine. So dependent primarily on the maternal thyroxine. So that is very, very important.
Dr. Sumitra.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak. I think the thyroid gland is able to optimize its function during pregnancy by balancing these factors. However, if it is already compromised, that is the time when we are able to see that hypothyroidism sets in. So, Dr. Shashi, you may continue with the panel.
Yeah. So, regarding placental transfer, small but significant transfer of normal T4 to the fetal circulation, but placenta is relatively impermeable to TSH and T3, and iodine is actively transported across the placenta from the maternal circulation to the fetus. Transplacental passage of TPO antibody is not. Am I audible? Hello?
Yeah, in between you had, we lost you, but you are audible now.
So TSH and SCG thyroglobulin transported across the placenta, this is as per ETA guideline, American Thyroid Association 2017. So my next question goes to Dr. Charu. Dr. Charu, how do you define overt and subclinical hypothyroidism? You know that frequently we talk about overt and subclinical hypothyroidism. So we need to have a proper definition or clarification about this.
Thank you, ma'am. So for the overt and subclinical hypothyroidism, we take the laboratory parameters. That is, if the TSH is abnormally high and the T4 levels are low, then it is considered as overt hypothyroidism. Whereas in subclinical hypothyroidism, the TSH level may be elevated in the presence of normal T4 levels.
Yes. So in overt hypothyroidism, the TSH levels are elevated and serum T4 and free T4 levels are low, and serum thyroid stimulating hormone will be equal to more than 10 milli international units per liter. And it is taken as overt hypothyroidism irrespective of free T4 levels. So the signs and symptoms are overt hypothyroidism are fatigue, weight gain, cold intolerance, constipation, dry skin, hair loss, muscle cramps, reduced memory or slower thinking, decreased PR, delayed relaxation of deep tendon reflexes, and causes are iodine deficiency, Hashimoto's thyroiditis, and post-radioiodine and thyroidectomy. So in subclinical hypothyroidism, as well said by Dr. Charu, the TSH level is elevated and it is less than 10 milliunits, international units per liter, and the serum T4 and FT ratio will be normal. So my next question goes to Dr. Mala, ma'am. Madam, what are the consequences of untreated hypothyroidism? We talk so much about treating hypothyroidism, so we need to know about the consequences.
See, hypothyroidism is a real problem for both the mother as well as the baby. We have to treat hypothyroidism because otherwise there are adverse maternal effects in the form of early miscarriages, recurrent pregnancy loss, anemia, preeclampsia, diabetes, abruption, postpartum hemorrhage. Then there can be also increased incidence of fetal distress during labor, which leads to increased incidence of instrumental delivery or cesarean section. Then rarely there can be myopathy, even congestive heart failure in severe cases. There can be incidence of IUGR, then fetal demise, respiratory distress, and increased perinatal mortality. Regarding the fetal effects, there can be preterm births, growth restricted, respiratory distress. All these can lead to perinatal morbidity as well as mortality in the fetus. So
thank you. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
So there are consequences both in the mother as well as in the fetus. So we have to take the hypothyroidism in the mother as very seriously, and we must treat the patients right in throughout the pregnancy, taking the TSH levels in each trimester, because we have to check the TSH levels and T4 levels in each trimester. It's not sufficient to check only in the first trimester or first visit. We must repeat the TSH level in second and third trimester so that we know that the maternal and the fetal outcomes are good at the end of the pregnancy.
So nicely explained by you, ma'am. In fact, this reminds me of a quote that when we need to do the thyroid profile and when we need to do the glycosylated hemoglobin. So it is usually said that TFTs are done every trimester. This is very important, as said by you. And hemoglobin, glycosylated hemoglobin, can be done only once in diabetes. So in newborns, cognitive, neurological, and developmental impairment occur, and thyroid hormone is critical for fetal brain development. Incidence of hypothyroidism in women with recurrent pregnancy loss is 4 to 16%. Miscarriage rate is 12 to 21% in subclinical, 21% significantly high. You know what hypothyroidism, rate of stillbirth is 0 to 16% in subclinical and 4.2% in overt hypothyroidism. Incidence of preeclampsia is 16% for overt hypothyroidism, 22% for subclinical, and incidence of aprepsia presenting is 16% for overt and 5% for subclinical. And IUGR2, 25% in overt hypothyroidism, 8% in subclinical, and preterm delivery incidence is 33% with overt hypothyroidism and 11% with subclinical. So my next question is to Dr. Mrilalini Nemani. Ma'am, what are the high risk factors for hypothyroidism and what will you ask the woman? Dr. Mani? Am I audible?
Yes, yes, you are audible.
Yeah. Dr. Mani, can you hear me?
Yeah. Dr. Shashi, I'm audible now?
Yes, yes, you are audible. Please go on.
So as I was mentioning, as covered by Dr. Deepak,
your sound is breaking a little bit.
Okay now.
Yeah.
So as covered by you,
ma'am, you can switch off your video, only then we will be,
I've done that. I think it should be better now.
Yes, ma'am.
So we are like in the gutter belt, like we are in Delhi, we are in the foot of the Himalaya, and we know that there's a high incidence of hypothyroid developing, and a lot of patients who come to us, we see to the tune of 20 to 25% also sometimes, depending on the area the patients are coming from. So we should be, the risk factor is very important in our country, is the area of residence where the study stays. And also obesity has become an epidemic in our country. And as we all know, this obesity is also a high risk factor for developing hypothyroidism. And more importantly, when we see these ladies coming to us, and it runs in families. So there has to, we have to see an important factor as being a family history of autoimmune thyroid disorder is there. And also if there is any history of patient undergoing having a goiter or any thyroid antibodies, if she has been tested, or she has clinical signs and symptoms of a thyroid disorders, she may be a known case of hypothyroid. So even in a hyperthyroid patient, if there's a very tight control, she can land up into hypothyroidism. Also certain autoimmune disorders like diabetes type 1, rheumatoid arthritis, SLE, celiac diseases, which we are seeing very commonly also now, patients are coming to us in the tertiary centers at least. They are also prone to having hypothyroidism. And we should also look whether a patient is on any medication like lithium and amitriptyline are known to suppress thyroid functions. And then any history of previous thyroid surgery. Patient may have had a thyroid surgery for goiter and she may be on replacement therapy, or any, she may have had cancer and which is the incidence is there in a country. She may have had a previous head and neck irradiation. That also should be asked for. And more importantly, we should also look if the patient had a prior treatment of infertility or history of miscarriages is there, or any preterm births. And also we have to inquire about preeclampsia or any abrupt show, stillbirth in the last previous frequency and delivery. And also about the mental status of the previous offspring, whether the baby was having any problem, whether there is a neurodevelopmental delay in the baby. That we have to see actually. So accordingly, knowing the high-risk factors, we can ask the question, the second part of which questions you ask. So depending upon these factors, we have to ask the patient about the previous obstetric history, family history we have to see, and also regarding the any baby having what.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Mani. You have covered almost everything regarding the questions and high-risk factors. So my next question is to Dr. Bharti. Ma'am, what is the screening recommendation for Indian population?
I think for the screening recommendation, if we go by the universal guidelines, still we are searching for the consensus. If you go by the PGA guidelines, they are neither recommending nor against the going for the screening, universal screening. Whether we talk about the endocrine society, they don't favor the screening for all. But if we look for the Indian Thyroid Society guidelines, they say, because looking at the prevalence high in Indian population and looking it to be endemic for iodine deficiency, we should go for the screening for all. And this
I do agree
for our institute also. So they say better you do the screening for all the females who are coming to you preconceptionally at least, and they want to conceive, or at least whenever they have coming to you for the first antenatal clinic. So if we go by the Indian scenario, we do recommend that we should go for it. But for looking for the screening for any disease, the two important factors they make are, you need to find out the prevalence of any disease. Another important thing is, if we screen, there should be a sufficient evidence to say that screening and treating the patient is going to benefit the pregnant female. So that's why there's still a controversy going on, but we do recommend that one should go for the screening for TSH in pregnant women in Indian scenario.
Yes, ma'am, I do agree, because there is still no consensus, but considering the prevalence of thyroid disease in our country, which is very important that soon the guideline will come that it will make a universal screening in India at least.
Yeah,
we have a single case
is missed. Universal screening in our hospital.
Yeah.
It's a universal screen.
Yes, 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 ma'am. That will prevent even a single case to happen.
Most of the
complications.
Yeah, in government, we do try to pick up these high-risk and at least do the screening in these high-risk patients.
Yeah. So, this is a case, 29-year-old primary gravida with 9 weeks pregnancy. Pregnancy with thyroid TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone 6.3 and T4-9. And what is the diagnosis?
May I answer, ma'am?
Meenakshi, can
you take
this question?
Yes, yes. Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Should I answer or?
Yes, yes, you can answer, Dr. Bharti, okay, come on.
Okay. So if you look, the TSH level is more than the reference range as per the pregnancy specific first trimester, which is to be 2.5, right? So it is more than that. So it is said to be hypothyroidism. Now we have to whether it is a overt or subclinical. So if I look at total T4 level, whatever T4 level has been there, they have been within the normal limit. So I can say this is a case of, because T4 levels are normal, but this is more than 2.5. So it is a case of hypothyroidism, but like subclinical one. Now, should I continue?
So how do you diagnose hypothyroidism, ma'am?
Hypothyroidism, for diagnosis of hypothyroidism, it is a pregnancy-specific level of TSH, which has to be taken in consideration for first trimester 2.5, and the second and third, it is 2-3, sorry, right? Yeah. So here, TSH levels, they are more than that. So it is more than this pregnancy-specific range, so it is a hypothyroidism. For diagnosing whether it is a subclinical or a overt, we need to look for the T4 level, T4, T3. Yeah. So here the T4 levels, what I am able to see is they are within the normal limit.
Yes, yes.
If you have shared, can you share the previous, please, the screen, please, previous slide.
This one?
Yes. So T4 is between, as such, said to be 9. So it is between 5 to 14. So it is normal. So if it is, this is a subclinical hypothyroidism as per diagnosis.
Right, now, right.
Rather to treat or not to treat for subclinical, they say as per recommendations, we can get anti-TPO antibodies done in these patients.
Yeah.
And if they are positive, these patients should be treated.
Yes, very nicely explained. So these are the range for different trimesters. So in pregnancy, subclinical hypothyroidism is defined as serum TSH between 2.5 to 10 milliunits per liter. So nicely explained by Dr. Bharti, with normal free T4 concentration. And overt hypothyroidism is defined as serum TSH more than 2.5 to 3 milli international units per liter with low free T4 levels. And anytime when TSH is more than 10 milli international units per liter, irrespective of FT4, it is called overt hypothyroidism. So Dr. Charu, can you tell us what is the methodology for the diagnosis?
Yeah, it's a very challenging question, ma'am, because in pregnancy, we usually measure the TSH and the free T4. And we all know that the free T4 is present in very less concentration, that is only about 0.03% of the total T4. So it is very difficult to measure this free T4. And when we see the reports, we see that the total T4 is measured in the nanogram range, whereas this free T4 is measured in the picogram range. Okay. And the method which is available is the equilibrium dialysis method and the ultrafiltration, but then it is very time consuming, labor intensive. So in many of the labs, they are using the indirect analog immunoassays. But again, in pregnancy, because of the increase in serum proteins in the concentration, the free T4 level again can vary. So the another method is that we can measure the total T4, which is easy to measure, and then we can calculate the free T4 index. And for that, we need to multiply it with the T3 resin uptake of the patient and the control.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Charu. So usually we take blood sample for collection and we keep the blood sample timing between like 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. where the levels are highest, and the venous blood samples taken with other antenatal care investigations in a single sitting, and equipment as said by Dr. Charu, and it can be an auto-analyzer or semi-auto-analyzer, and samples analyzed using chemiluminescence assay, auto-analyzer or semi-auto-analyzer. So my next question is to Dr. Mala. Madam, what is the role and effect of anti-TP antibodies? We talk so much about these antibodies. So what is their role in the management of thyroid disorder in pregnancy?
See, we have to understand that if anti-TP antibodies are present, that has to be taken very seriously. Even if the anti-TP antibodies present even in overt or subclinical hypothyroidism, these patients need to be treated, because otherwise it does not improve the perinatal outcome. Treatment of these women significantly improves if they start treating them with overt hypothyroidism or subclinical hypothyroidism if the anti-TPO antibodies are present. Because positive antibody thyroid bodies is associated with increased risk of miscarriages and prematurity and other adverse outcome. So anti-TPO antibodies should be checked. The TSH is more than 2.5 in the first trimester. As Dr. Deepak had already highlighted, that when the TSH is between 2.5 to 4, the anti-TPO antibodies must be checked. And if it is positive, then you have to consider treatment. Yes. And if it is negative, then definitely no treatment is required. But even if the patient is euthyroid with anti-TPO antibodies, then we have to consider treatment in high-risk patients, like patients with recurrent pregnancy loss, patients with previous preterm labor, previous IUD, or other adverse perinatal outcome. We should treat those patients with that anti-TPO.
So beautifully answered by you, ma'am. So the American Thyroid Association 2017 recommends assessment of TPO antibody only when testing for thyroid autoimmunity. And currently, universal screening for thyroid antibodies is not recommended by any professional organization. And madam has already said the complications. In a euthyroid women with positive anti-TPO antibody, maternal risk are infertility, RPL, preterm labor, placental abruption, postpartum depression, increased risk of progression to thyroid disease, and in fetus, respiratory membrane disease. So my next question is to Dr. Mrinalini Mani, ma'am. Madam, what is the drug of, we have discussed hypothyroidism, we have diagnosed hypothyroidism, now what is the drug of choice? And what are the contraindications or indications for that? Dr. Mani?
Can you hear me now? Yeah.
Yes, we are here. We are able to hear you, but somehow your sound is breaking.
I switch off my video. Maybe the
You please switch off your video and
now it is better.
Yeah, it is a little better. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So basically, as we all are aware, levothyroxine sodium is available as tablet. That is a drug of choice. And a certain thing which we have to keep in mind while taking these tablets when we prescribe to the patient. It's very important to how the patient takes these tablets and how she stores them. Actually, we have to tell her that to take these tablets empty stomach first thing in the morning, and she should not take anything for half an hour to 1 hour after taking these tablets. And also one thing has to be kept in mind is that these tablets are to be stored in a dark place away from moisture, heat and light. Normally what happens is when we tell the patient, yet goli aapko subah subah khani hai. So either people keep these tablets in the kitchen or in the washroom. So, but this moisture and the heat will have reduce the efficacy of the tablets. Also, we have to tell them to take this tablet with a glass full of water, not to swallow this saliva, which what is the goli or saliva se convert. Because it rapidly swells up when it comes in touch with saliva and disintegrates. What happens is sometimes they can be choking or gagging. So a lot of patients tell us, madam, jab goli khati hu, goli usse khai nahi jati hai, gale ke niche nahi utarti hai. So we have to tell them this. And also, there are certain drugs which do affect the thyroid hormone absorption. So what we particularly are routine tablets which we give, iron and the calcium. Iron also we tell the patient to take empty stomach, so she may be taking iron. We have to tell them not to take iron and calcium supplements. And also, most of the patients have gastritis. A lot of people are prescribed antacids. So not to be taken with antacids also. So these are the few things. And certain foods also interfere, like cabbage, broccoli, soya, we tell patients, vegetarian, soya, jade khao, nuts, slow. So all these interfere. And coming to, should I continue regarding the dosage? Is basically, it has to be kept 1 to 2 microgram per kg per 100. So there's a whole lot of schedule of starting the dosage if the patient is not on that. And we have to adjust the dose so as to maintain the serum level less than 2.5 milliunits per liter. And we have to, as Dr. Deepak had also said, when we start the dose, we have to monitor the levels 3 to 4 weeks after every dose adjustments to keep the levels at a lower level.
Yeah. Right? Thank you, Dr. Mani. So, regarding the metabolism of levothyroxine, it rapidly disintegrates to be taken with full glass of water, as ma'am has said, and 40 to 80% of orally administered LT4 is absorbed, majority from the jejunum and upper ileum. Peak blood levels reached at 4 to 6 weeks. As Dr. Mani has said, iron, calcium, and antacids, they all decrease the absorption of thyroxine, and it should not be administered within 4 hours of these agents. It is eliminated in urine by 80% and 20% in stools. And regarding packaging, I would like to say a few words. The strength required for this is like 25 microgram, 50 microgram, 100 microgram, and it has to be supplied, as ma'am has said, in moisture tight packages, stored at room temperature. Exposure to direct sunlight or heat should be avoided at all times. And levothyroxine sodium, this is very important for all the delegates, and if any postgraduate student is attending our webinar, that it belongs to category A, the best category for medicines prescribed during pregnancy, and it can be used safely during pregnancy and lactation without any adverse effect on the mother and the fetus. If the dose is missed on one day, the patient may take the same as soon as she remembers and should not eat anything for the next half an hour. And if she misses the tablet altogether, she should take double the dose on the next morning. And the complete bottle of levothyroxine tablets should be provided to the patients. And these are the strengths. And yeah, madam, would you like to say anything about contraindication, Dr. Mani?
See, this is a very safe drug. There are hardly any side effects. And most of the side effects are due to the wrong dosage and because of the hyperthyroidism which can occur with the dose. And contraindications, almost none. But we have to keep in mind certain things when we give these to the patients. Like if a patient has a lady has a history of any heart cardiac problem, or she's a diabetic, or she has an adrenal or pituitary problem, in those cases we have to be cautious because acute MI can be precipitated and uncorrected adrenal insufficiency can be precipitated, adrenal crisis can be precipitated.
So, yeah, ma'am, so by and large, there are no contraindications except a few
very safe,
which ma'am has said to take. So my next question is to Dr. Bharti. Ma'am, what are the common medications that may interact? There are no major contraindications but there may be some interactions.
Yes, ma'am, most of the thing have been already been covered. The common medications which we prescribe in pregnancy, we talk about calcium, we talk about iron, definitely. They say because here they are basically lessening the acids, and it levothyroxine absorption is by the increased acid. So anything which is decreasing the acid production definitely leads to decreased production of absorption of LT4. So any drugs, anti-acids, gelosil, or any form of proton pump inhibitors or any bile acids to get strengths. So all these drugs basically decreasing the LT4 absorption. So one thing to be advised to the patient is at least to keep the gap of 3 to 4 hours, which has already been said there.
Yeah.
And important thing is because this drug is going for the enterohepatic circulation and there is a recycling of this drug.
Yeah.
So the important thing is any rifampicin or these anticoagulants, they are the drugs which basically causes this drug's decreased activity. So rifampicin or other ATPs mainly, they causes a decreased activity of LT4. And when it is taken concomitant with the anticoagulants, so with blood thinners, their bleeding tendencies of the patients, they are increasing. And antidepressants, amitriptyline, they are also the drugs which are interacting
yes,
with
yes.
And decreasing the efficiency. So the, here the things are the drugs which are basically suppressing the acid secretions or which are basically going through the enterohepatic circulations. They are the both types of drugs which are basically interacting with the LT4 and the decreasing its efficiency or increasing its basically a stay in the blood.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Bharti, very nicely explained. And over to Dr. Sumitra for next set of questions, ma'am. Dr. Sumitra?
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
So the next, we move on to, like you've already diagnosed and you've put her on treatment. So the next question is, how do you plan and monitor the treatment? So there can be two conditions. Either we have diagnosed the hypothyroidism in pregnancy and now we have to manage that, or, you know, she was preconceptionally diagnosed and she was already on some treatment. So again, this question was for Dr. Meenakshi. So would any other panelists like to take this question?
I can take this.
As to how you will monitor the treatment. Okay, Dr. Mani, yes, ma'am.
Actually, we have already discussed the levels mentioned, the optimum level has to be maintained. So in the first trimester, we have to keep the level at all times less than 2.5 and less than 3 the second and third trimester. And and when we start treatment on this patient, what we have to do is we have to keep monitoring the lady and have a repeat sample to be taken after 4 to 6 weeks to optimize these levels. And initially, if the level is between 2.5 to 10, that is, if she has a subclinical hypothyroid, the normal T4 level, we can start straight away start with 25 micrograms of levothyroxine every day. The gynecologist, we can start this ourselves. And of course, yes, we should take a consultation from our physician or our endocrinologist part. But this tablet, 25 microgram, as we know, we learned that it has hardly any side effects. So we can immediately start without wasting any time. It can be started. And if the initial level is more than 10, then the treatment will continue the same doses after the delivery also. Otherwise, if the level was less than 10 and once the patient delivers, then we have to see and decrease the levels or even stop the treatment in that case. And if we keep monitoring these levels, depending upon the TSH levels, we can do our titrate the drug dose. Actually, the rule of thumb is if we have to increase by increment of 25. For example, if she was the level was more than 2.5, we have started 25 in first trimester, increase by 50. If it was 75, increase 200, so and so forth. And similarly, in the second, third trimester, again, the level has to be kept below 3, and we titrate it by increasing by 25% every time. That's what we do. And keep in mind is not...
Yes.
Dr. Sumitra, ma'am, sound
yeah,
is...
Yeah, thank breaking. You, Dr. Hello, Dr. Shashi, am I audible?
Yes, Dr. Sumitra, you are audible. Ma'am has nicely said... her okay. Sound is little breaking, so I am just requesting you to summarize from this slide.
Yeah. So if the patient is already, I just say that if the patient has already been, you know, or started, if she's been diagnosed in pregnancy, ma'am has already clearly said that if it is less than 10, we start on, 25. If it is more than 10, we start her on 50. And if she was already on treatment preconceptionally, then we continue that treatment, but we need to check the TSH levels once in the first trimester, and then we need to repeat the levels every 6 weeks, because the half-life of T4 is around 1 week. So we need to repeat around 4 to 6 weeks, especially in the first trimester. We may do it more frequently because there are maximum fluctuations which occur in because there is a release of SPG in the first trimester, as we have already discussed earlier. So there we will check for the TSH levels every 4 weeks, and later we can check every 6 weeks. And depending on the levels, then this is a ready reconner which you are showing, that you know how depending on the TSH levels, whatever was the current dose, if it doesn't, the TSH level is not as per the trimester specific level, we can increase it by 25. And however, we must also remember that at all times we need to avoid that, you know, the TSH should not go below 0.1. So of course, we know the trimester specific range, we will adhere to that. But if we are over treating, so next slide please, Dr. Shashi. TSH should, it should be avoided, that you know we the TSH should not go below 0.1 because then we are over treating her. So that also, there is a ready reconner. Next slide please. So we can, you know, see that if the current dose was say 50 and the TSH has gone below 0.1, then we would need to change and reduce the dose. So here also we can for the, as a thumb rule, we can apply the same as reducing the dose by 25 micrograms. So in both conditions, we can use this thumb rule of 25 micrograms.
So this is very important chart. Showing the implement, how to start, how to increase and how to decrease the dose. Very nicely said by Dr. Sumitra. So next question, Dr. Sumitra, you please, over to you.
Yes, so the next question is for Dr. Charu. Dr. Charu, so now she's already started on treatment, and so what will be the next step regarding the follow-up? Like, would you like to do some specific screening for the fetus, and when would you plan to terminate this pregnancy?
Yes, ma'am. The monitoring has been nicely explained. So now, after delivery, if she was, whatever the pre-pregnancy dose she was taking, so after delivery, she can continue on that pre-pregnancy dose, because whatever we have increased, now we have to decrease, as the requirement is now decreased. And secondly, if...
Dr. Charu, I was asking you about the antenatal care. The care of the pregnancy, would you do any specific management other than, you know, of course, modifying the dose? When would you plan to terminate this pregnancy? Would you take her till term?
The pregnancy usually
would you want
we
to deliver
prefer
her earlier.
We usually prefer to terminate at 40 weeks. We don't go beyond 40 weeks. So our protocol is that we terminate at 40 weeks. And regarding the question that was asked about what is the effect of this hypothyroidism on the fetus, so this has been already discussed that on the fetus, there are chances of miscarriages, then there are chances of preterm birth, the low birth weight babies are there, and after the delivery, there are chances that neurocognitive impairment and decreased IQ, these are the problems with maternal hypothyroidism.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Charu. So if we can take her till term for delivery, the only thing is that if she doesn't develop any other complications, you know, she can even be followed up at a concerned CHC or even a PHC, and her managed treatment can be managed there, and she can actually deliver. But of course, if she develops certain complications, associated complications, then she can deliver at any higher center. And any other specific monitoring for the fetus is not required. Whatever is our routine antenatal care, we continue to follow that. So thank you, Dr. Charu. And the next question is for Dr. Mala. Ma'am, is there any difference in the antenatal and in the postpartum therapy now that we have, delivered her? So what would be our plan now?
See, if the TSH was more than 10 at any point of time and we had treated her with levothyroxine, then she continues with the same dose in the postpartum period. If the TSH level was between 3 to 10, then in that case, in the immediate postpartum period, we may discontinue, but you have to check the thyroid profile 6 weeks after delivery. If she was pre-pregnancy level, at the pre-pregnancy point, she was taking thyroid medicines, levothyroxine, then she has to go back to the pre-pregnancy dose of the thyroxine level, which was she was taking. So these are the three situations that we have to monitor in the postpartum period. in all the conditions, we have to check the thyroid profile after 6 weeks of delivery so that we can titrate it and fine tune the dose of the levothyroxine to the TSH level and T4 levels.
Thank you, ma'am. Very nicely explained that again, the same easily we can remember that if she was, receiving, if the TSH was more than 10, and we can continue the same. Otherwise, if she was earlier on some regime pre-pregnancy, we again continue the same. And 50 and below, we can stop the treatment. There is a flow chart also. We can, keep that with us and we can refer to the chart. And the chart very nicely summarizes the same thing. Dr. Shashi, should we go ahead? Because I think this has already been discussed.
Will you speak something about chart or should I move to the next slide? It is self-explanatory.
Yeah, I think we can read out. Okay. So we've already discussed this, that if it is less than, pregnancy specific range, if it is already, below 2.5 in the first trimester and less than 3 in the second and third, no treatment is required. And then if it is, between 2.5 to 10, in the first trimester or between 3 to 10 in the second and third trimester, then we can start her on 25, levothyroxine, and we can stop this treatment in the postpartum period, right? Now, if it was more than 10 and we have started her on treatment that is in any trimester, then we start straight away with 50 and then the same treatment can be continued postpartum. So anything below 50, we can, just stop. Then pregnant women on treatment which have been diagnosed preconceptionally, then the dose has to be modified, according to the TSH levels in the second and third trimester. And then postpartum, she can again go back to the same regime. So always remember that you have to repeat the TSH 6 weeks postpartum for further management. Now, the key points in this are that, we must screen all patients at risk for hypothyroidism. For us, of course, we are following that we are going to screen every pregnancy for hypothyroidism or any thyroid disorder and treat if the TSH value is above the defined upper limit. Again and again, this has been reiterated. And levothyroxine 25, if it is TSH which is between the upper limit of that trimester and 10, and we can start her on 25. If it is more than 10, we start her on 50. And then postpartum, accordingly, we can stop or we continue on what she was in the pre-pregnancy period. But always remember to do the TSH 4 to 6 weeks after delivery to assess the further requirement. And in case, mostly the antenatal care can continue routinely as such, and specialist referral can be done if she develops any associated other complications. Yeah. Next slide, please. So these are, of course, based on the ATA guidelines that, we've prepared this. And the recommendations, of course, are for the US is that they should ingest 250 micrograms of iodine daily. Of course, here in our country, we do have the, the iodine fortified salt also. So I think most of the women are aware and that is very commonly available. So that I think is the GOI guideline and that is being, recommended and that is being also made available to everybody. And of course, the optimal time, optimally it would be if pre-pregnancy we were able to have achieve a euthyroid status before she plans conception. So pre-conception counseling and when she comes to us in that period to be able to, test her and guide her would be the best scenario before she plans for conception. Yeah. Next slide, please, Dr. Shashi. So this is just a question for Dr. Deepak. So would you like to explain what is isolated hypothyroxinemia? Is it of concern? Should we monitor such a lady or, we can just let her be? And would she need any treatment?
I think Dr. Deepak has left because he had made a comment. There was some patient requiring attention. He has left. So I think you can continue.
So Dr. Mani, would you like to take this question?
Okay.
Or anybody?
Yeah. So the
isolated is now better, much better.
Now my sound is better.
Now, video.
I can close my video. So basically, this isolated hypothyroxinemia, as the name suggests, here the T4 concentration is in the lowest percentile of a given population with a normal maternal TSH concentration. TSH is normal, only F3 T4 is less. So the main thing which we are concerned here is because in such cases, the neonate, the cognitive impairment is there, and this we have to see, and this should be routinely treated in pregnancy, because when the child will be born and this would have been missed, we'll keep on, the parents will be after parents, but mother particularly, padhta nahi hai, but sadly we would be forgetting that we did not test her levels. And also during the pregnancy, here in these cases there are more chances of having miscarriages, low birth weight babies, preterm labors, and more chances of when lady goes in labor, the fetal heart rate abnormalities are there, so therefore increasing cesarean section rates are there. And also these patients are more prone to having preeclampsia, and they can land up in placental abruption and postpartum hemorrhage subsequently. So definitely this needs to be taken care of.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Mani. And the next, of course, again in continuity, that what is postpartum thyroiditis and how is it managed?
Yeah, postpartum thyroiditis prevalence is about 8%, and we do get these cases also in our country. The important point is that these patients were previously not diagnosed. It's a new onset abnormal TSH and free T4 after delivery within 12 months, within a year that is. So what happens here is it's an autoimmune response. So what happens is initially the thyroid gland is destroyed by the antibodies and T4 is released. So there is a bit of thyrotoxicosis. Mild symptoms need to be controlled, and beta blockers also have to be given here. In the second phase, what happens when the gland is getting repaired, and after 4 to 8 months, there is overt hypothyroidism with typical symptoms, and there's a thyromegaly also. And there can be sometimes permanent overt hypothyroidism also in such cases, and these patients can land up in depression. So what happens is, so basically there is a transient hypothyroidism alone, there can be transient hypothyroidism, or there's a hypothyroidism followed by hypothyroidism, and then there is a spontaneous recovery. And sometimes it has been seen that even in induced abortions, in 3 to 16% cases, we can have this postpartum thyroiditis type of picture can be there. And this has to be distinguished from Graves' hypothyroidism, which is also some incidence is there in our country also. Here, the important difference is we don't have the eye changes. The ophthalmopathy, which is present in Graves, is not in these postpartum thyroiditis patients. So every postpartum, these patients have to be reevaluated 3 to 4 weekly. And in the treatment part, antithyroids have no role in this. And some may require treatment if the hypothyroid is significantly low levels. And mainly it is recommended to maintain the thyroxine until childbearing is complete, with an attempt to wean off medication 1 year after the last delivery. So this we have to take care of and screen our patients for this.
Yes, anything else you would like very to nice add? Summarized. And whatever the factors which initiates postpartum thyroiditis, as you very nicely explained, that there is actually destruction of the thyroid follicle. So initially there's a surge and there is a release of T4, 3G, T3, which is unregulated. And then ultimately the stores become exhausted, and then it goes into the hypothyroid state. So you very nicely explained that how we need to be aware of and we need to manage that. In most cases, they actually do not require the L-thyroxine therapy. And to differentiate it from the Graves' disease, we can look at the type of antibodies which are present, because in the Graves, you would find the thyroid receptor stimulating antibodies. Next slide, please, Dr. Shashi. So one thing is, of course, in postpartum thyroiditis, those women who have thyroid anti-TPO antibodies are more prone. So in those women especially, we can be more vigilant. So the next question is for Dr. Bharti. Dr. Bharti, is there a role of termination of pregnancy if the TSH is more than, say, 100? This was already, of course, discussed by Dr. Deepak also. Yes. So you could just quickly give a little brief answer.
I work with you. This is look at this question. This is ethically very, very important, but still debatable. If we go by the clause of MTP and we look for the factors where we are going to call this pregnancy termination, So there are the three most important factors we always consider for MTPs: social, maternal, and eugenic. So here we are going to try to fit the pregnancy into a eugenic cause. Eugenic means where the child is going to be produced with severely mental or physically handicapped. So in physically handicapped, if we see the clause in MTP Act, they have talked about molecular problems, they have talked about aneuploidies, they have talked about structural problems, rubella infections, radiations, but nowhere at least they have mentioned that overt hypothyroidism producing such kind of abnormalities and fitting into the clause. But yes, we have to give the patient-centered approach in such cases, and we need to review the cases, because we do understand that uncontrolled overt hypothyroidism in pregnancy in first trimester may result in severe neuropsychological, developmental, and cognitive functions of the fetus. But that is a qualitative assessment. So what the other factors need to be looked for is that what kind of pregnancy. It may be that she has associated so many problems, or it may be a pregnancy which is very precious for her, or she may be a mother of previously affected mentally child and she doesn't want to carry the pregnancy. So this has to be a very patient-centered discussion, and the any discussion and conclusion should come from the patient side, and we should tell the patient that despite starting the effective dose in the beginning also, there still remains a potential risk of that cognitive affection of the child, and the decision has to come from the patient side. She may have a problems, multiple problems in her family. It may be a multi-parous lady and she has 3-4 kids and it is a by chance pregnancy, and then she may consider. So this decision is still challenging, but we need to look into the other parameters. We need, the approach has to be individualized, and if we go by the guidelines, as such, there is no recommendation for termination of pregnancies in such patients by laws if the value is so high.
Yeah, so very nicely answered, Dr. Bharti. Every case should be individualized, and as Dr. Deepak had, you know, shared in his talk also, that he had shared how he had followed a cohort of his own cases. He was sharing that how he had followed a cohort group, and he found that most of them were actually doing well, and few of them had opted for MTP. So I think since there are currently no recommendations and there are no guidelines as such that you find the cutoff of TSH, say 20, 30, 40, and you counsel the patient for termination, we need to discuss, and we need to discuss with them, the couple, that, what are the implications of having a high TSH level. And of course, the treatment is available, but what would be the neurocognitive outcome, that would be questionable. And as you very rightly said, that we can individualize and we can counsel them. Of course, we have to remain within the PCPNDT gamut also, that, any pregnancy which is less than 20 weeks, right? So next question, please. Thank you, Dr. Bharti. Next question, please. This question, again, I think an open question. Since Dr. Meenakshi is not there with us, have you encountered fetal hypothyroidism or fetal goiter? And if you have, would you throw light on how it should be managed? A little rarer condition, would any panelists like to take that? We have esteemed panelists with
Sumitra,
us.
Sumitra, you can.
Mala ma'am. Okay, so... maybe next slide, please, Dr. Shashi. Should we continue?
Yeah, we can continue with this.
The last question, the previous question, the fetal goiter, the most of these cases of fetal goiter, if at all they are present, they can be a consequence of fetal hypothyroidism, which could be due to the, transplacentally derived antithyroid drugs, which were used to treat maternal hyperthyroidism. These can cross the placenta and can affect the fetus, leading to fetal hypothyroidism. So if we have a lady who's on these antithyroid drugs, then we need to very carefully monitor her, and we need to see the level of the antibodies. At 24 to 26 weeks, we need to check the level of those thyroid receptor antibodies and then decide, on the treatment. And a lesser common cause of hypothyroid goiter is congenital dyshormogenesis due to defects in genes which are involved in the pathway of thyroid hormone production. So this could be one of the rarer causes. And in these cases, the fetus will have an impaired growth and the fetus will have bradycardia. So this is one of the rarer cases we come across of fetal thyroid goiter. Dr. Shashi, you can change the slide. And rarely there can be a hyperthyroid goiter also. And this is caused by transplacentally derived maternal thyroid stimulating immunoglobulin. So goiter may be hypothyroid, it may be hyperthyroid, but as I said, the hypothyroid, we may still be able to, you know, monitor for and look for it if the lady is on antithyroid drugs. The rarer hyperthyroid goiter, which is caused by maternal thyroid stimulating immunoglobulin, they may be seen again in Graves' disease. In this condition, because being a fetal medicine specialist, I would just like to say this condition you would encounter in case of fetal hydrops. So that is important. If you come across a case of fetal hydrops, you must also inquire into this. That is it, if especially you know that the, you know, the lady had Graves' disease. So in these cases, we need to, of course, do a detailed ultrasound examination. And if we look at the maternal condition, we can diagnose whether this is a hypothyroid goiter or this is a hyperthyroid fetal goiter. If we are in doubt, we can even do the fetal blood sampling and a cordocentesis. And then there we can check for the fetal thyroxine levels, hormonal levels. And usually the only thing is that if it is a large goiter, then, you know, we may have to do an exit procedure. Because then a large goiter, a large mass which is compressing the trachea, so that is an exit procedure, which is an ex utero intervention. As soon as the fetus baby is delivered, the baby may need intubation or the baby may need, you know, tracheostomy or some kind of a support. So we move on to the next question, which is a question for Dr. Charu. Dr. Charu, should neonates be screened for hypothyroidism? Is there a universal screening for all neonates?
Yes, ma'am, definitely the neonates should be screened. And according to the latest update by the American Academy of Pediatricians, they have said that all the newborns should be screened between 2 to 4 days. And they have a three types of screening strategies. They say you can do a primary TSH, and if it is high, then you can go for a backup T4, or you can go for a primary T4 and then a backup TSH, or a simultaneous T4 and TSH, which is much better. So definitely the screening has to be done, and it should be between 2 to 4 days. And suppose if this window is missed, then at least before discharge, we can test the newborn, or at least within 7 days. And regarding within the first 48 hours, it should not be tested because we can have false positive and the false negative results. So the TSH may be falsely elevated, or it may be decreased in a critically ill baby. So as soon as, and it is also the responsibility that as soon as the abnormal results come, this should be immediately communicated to the treating physician so that the immediate treatment and management can be started.
Can I add, Dr. Sumitra? I just wanted to add that this universal screening is on the way, because some of the states have this dream project called NEEV, Neonatal Early Evaluation Vision. In this, congenital hyperthyroidism will be a part of screening, along with congenital adrenal hyperplasia and other, this endocrinopathies in neonates, which should be detected early so as to be treated early to prevent their, regression of mental faculty. So this is a very, very good project which is coming up. I think Delhi government is in the process of taking it up. So
yeah, this is a GOI dream project, and for preventing of childhood neonatal intervention, one of the neonatal intervention, and Delhi is on the lines. This is a pipeline, Dr. Neeta, as you rightly said.
Over to you, Dr.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Anita, for that input. And very rightly said that, Dr. Charu, that it has to be done after 48 hours. So that we must remember. And between 2 to 5 days after birth. And we must also remember that, as we know, that physiology of the neonate, that as soon as the baby is born, there can be a sudden surge. So that's why we need to avoid the first 48 hours and then test. And as Dr. Anita has very, nicely given us the input that it is going to become part of the universal neonatal screening, along with screening for other disorders. So the next question is for Dr. Mala. Ma'am, what is the effect of the antithyroid drugs on lactation? Because she would be worried that, she is on treatment and she needs to continue that in the postpartum period. So would that affect the lactation also? And both the types of drugs, if you could comment
on. Thyroxine. Then it is definitely secreted in the breast milk. but it doesn't have any neurodevelopment effect on the baby. But if the mother is on propylthiouracil, the maximum dose that it can be given is 300 milligram per day, but no data on the neurodevelopment effect of the baby is seen. And if the mother is on metamizole, again, it is secreted in the breast milk, but the maximum dose recommended is 20 milligram per day, but it does not have any significant effect on the neurodevelopment effect of the baby. So these drugs are secreted, but does not have much effect on the neurodevelopment effect on the fetus. And as we earlier said, if the mother was on levothyroxine pre-pregnancy, then they have to continue this drug in the postpartum period. And if the level of TSH was between 3 to 10, then in the postpartum period, we can withdraw the levothyroxine from the mother. And if the patient was having TSH more than 10, then of course they have to continue with the thyroid medication in the postpartum period. And all the conditions, we have to check the thyroid profile after 6 weeks of delivery in the postpartum period to maintain the euthyroid state and to know the status of the mother so far as thyroid profile is concerned.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. Very nicely summarized that, we need to just modify the dose in the postpartum period, and then we need to test for the TSH again at 6 weeks postpartum. Thank you, ma'am. So we move to the last question of the panel. Dr. Charu, what is the target preconceptional level of TSH for a woman with hypothyroidism? She is now delivered and she continues to take her medication, or she's planning the next pregnancy. So what should be the target level of TSH for this lady? How would you counsel her?
I think the level can be, it should be less than 4.
Can take that question. The level should be, I mentioned in the previous slide also, we're discussing the target should be less than 2.5. So the most important thing in preconceptual counseling is that we have to be alert for these problems, and particularly in cases who are diabetics and epileptics, and also those patients with infertility or menstrual problems, we have to be alert. And it's a good thing now these days, particularly in the private sector, patients are coming for preconceptional counseling. And of course, if she's a known case of hypothyroidism, the level has to be optimized. And our goal is to optimize the thyroid function and educate these patients preparation for conception, and also tell these patients the other risk factors like smoking, alcohol, diet should be there and should be taken care of. Adequate iodine intake should be there. And also to mention that if she's a known case of hypothyroidism, then her doses have to be changed and she needs a regular follow-up is required. Her dosage would be changed in pregnancy, like we have already discussed. So this need to be emphasized to this patient.
So thank you, Dr. Mani, for that very crisp answer. And with that, we come to the end of the panel. And I can see that there are a lot of questions also in the chat box. Request to Dr. Anita, ma'am, if you could.
There are 4 or 5 questions, and a few have been partially answered. First was about titration of thyroxine in pregnancy. I think Dr. Shashi and Dr. Sumitra have discussed in detail. Will you just reply again in crisp manner? Just summarize, ma'am. Anybody? Dr. Sumitra, you can just tell in 2 or 3 lines.
We are coming to the chart that will summarize it beautifully.
Yeah, there is a chart. So Dr. Shashi, she wants us to remember this chart. We can put it up in our clinics also.
Yes.
But remember that if she has the TSH level is at the appropriate, trimester specific level, there is no need to start the treatment. So 2.5 for the first trimester, 3 for the second and the third trimester. Now, if the TSH level is between 2.5 to 10 in the first trimester, and it is between 3 to 10 in the second and third trimester, then what should we do? So that is the time we can start her on treatment, and we can start her on 25 L-troxine per day during that. And of course, we have to keep on monitoring this by doing the TSH levels every 4 weeks in the first trimester and 6 weeks in the second and the third trimester. And once this lady delivers, then there is this treatment can be stopped if it is less than, she was on less than 50 micrograms. Fine. Now, if the TSH was more than 10, then in any trimester, then she has to be started on atropin or levothyroxine 50 micrograms per day. And the same dose can be continued if she remains stable. The TSH remains controlled on that dose, then the same can be continued in the postpartum period. And all these women would need to be tested for TSH again at 6 weeks. Now, the ladies who fall in a different category, who were already on some treatment in the pre-pregnancy period, they can be started, you know, continued on that, and can be monitored every 4 to 6 weeks, and the dose can be accordingly modified to keep the TSH at the trimester-specific level. At this time, please remember that don't over-treat. And, you know, you have a TSH which is going below 0.1. So whether you have to increase the dose or you have to decrease, depending on the TSH, do it by a thumb rule of 25 micrograms. And thus, you modify and keep it under check. And once she delivers, a lady who was already on some dose in the pre-pregnancy period can be continued on the same. And again, she needs to be monitored in the same way at 6 weeks postpartum.
Thank you, Dr.
I think the important, sorry, Dr. Anita, the important point here is the follow-up is very important. We have to emphasize on these ladies, particularly patients coming to the public sector. They tend to lost ek dibba go, ek puri shishi mil gai, ab ye khani, chemist leke kha lenge. It has to be emphasized and we have to tell them that your child may be affected. So that initial counseling is very, very important. That's what I feel.
Another question is regarding in preconception. If a patient is planning for conception, should you start thyroxine in a patient who is planning conception and it has been detected that TSH is just above 2.5? I think all infertility specialists vouch for that we should start levothyroxine in these patients.
Yes, we can start with 25
micrograms. Anti-TPO antibodies as well in these patients.
Yes.
Yes, yes.
So antibodies are present and the levels are more than 2.5, then we may have to think of starting the levothyroxine in these patients.
One query is, why TFT is done fasting? Is it mandatory?
No.
It depends upon the lab, you know. It depends upon the labs. Nowadays, they don't say fasting.
Yes.
Previously, the tests which were available used to be fasting, but nowadays it is not mandatory.
Yeah, nowadays some other methods of assessment. New machines have come, so they do not require fasting.
Endocrinologists are already same opinion that fasting is not required, especially if a follow up is being done for a patient who is on treatment. So if patient can manage like fasting, it's okay, but if it is not mandatory that the patient should be fasting to do the TFT. Regarding
the only thing is that the peak levels are between 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. So maybe we can plan taking a sample around that time.
There is another question. If a patient is euthyroid, should we start treating them with thyroxine? If patient has presented with infertility or RPL, I think she was talking about raised TSH or something like that. But the patient, she's saying that T3, T4 levels are normal.
She's talking about a patient who has a bad obstetric history, RPL, or maybe she was infertile, but she is in thyroid. But her TPO antibodies are positive. So should we start her on treatment? If only the antibodies are positive and she has a bad obstetric history or she has been infertile.
So I think we can keep her under
and her anti-TPO antibodies to be done. Only then, if they are positive, only then it is to be started.
They are positive.
She has said that it is positive. How will you determine dose of thyroxine in euthyroid patients with infertility or RPL with positive anti-TPO? So she's asking whether we should give thyroxine or not, especially in RPL.
No, if anti-TPO is positive, but the level of TSH and T3, T4 are normal, she needs to be under close observation.
Yes.
But she doesn't need to be started.
Yes. Then, ma'am, there was another question. What is the relevance of weight of the patient in calculation of dose of ultroxin or levothyroxine? Sorry. Is weight important?
No, not mentioned in any literature.
Yeah, there is no reference as such.
That is mentioned.
Yeah. There was another question regarding the I think we have answered that, but if preconception TSH is more than 2.5 in a patient who is trying to conceive, levothyroxine to be started or not? What if TPO is negative?
What is the TSH level preconception?
More than 2.5, she has just mentioned this.
I think this question so many times has been answered.
The last slide.
She was just mentioning if even if
maintain less than 2.5.
Yeah, everyone has been discussing this only to maintain less than 2.5.
So it doesn't make any difference if the level is less than 2.5, you have to treat it preconceptionally.
No, not less. If it is more than 2.5, TPO positive. Only TPO positive.
Less than 2.5 is the optimal level. Actually, more than 2.5, then we need to treat it.
Yes, more than 2.5.
2.5 is the cutoff. We have mentioned in our last slide.
2.5 to 4, they say, no?
Actually, she's asking whether it is irrespective of TPO positivity or not. Actually, the query is this. If TSH is more than 2.5,
TPO positive, which we can start with 25 microgram minimal dose, and if she is TPO negative, we should not start.
Yes, that answers her question. So I think there are no more questions in the chat box. So anything?
I think it was a truly A to Z class. You know, starting from the beginning, preconception, conception, post conception, and I think after this webinar, people who have attended, they can make no mistakes. The important points were again and again reiterated, you know. So I think it was a very, very useful webinar. Truly.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations, Shashi, Sumitra, and Anita for conceiving it. And all the panelists were very good. I wish we had Dr. Dinesh till the end because
Dr. Sabli had to go back to it. So can we go with vote of thanks now, Dr. Shashi?
Yeah, Dr. Anita, I must thank Dr. Achalak Bakra, ma'am. She has always given support. She had planned the whole program. She has given me dates, everything. She has suggested all the speakers, all the guests. Ma'am, thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. And thank you, Dr. Sumitra. She was always there with me. And right from the beginning of the start of panel, and almost every day we interacted because we wanted this panel to be very good. We meant it to be really A to Z. And thank you all the panelists, Dr. Mrinalini Mani, Dr. Mala, Dr. Bharti Joshi, Dr. Charu, Dr. Anita. In fact, we changed the date and they all had cooperated and they were available. And Dr. Anita, lots of thanks to you. You have conducted the program so nicely. It decreased our headache. We concentrated on the panel and we wish you all the success for your medical disorders FOXI committee.
Thank you, Dr. Shashi. And of course, besides all the respected faculty, we miss Dr. Meenakshi and Dr. Rakhi Singh, definitely, in the panel. And I must thank all the delegates also who have joined and sat through all along these 2 hours. And because no event can be successful without delegates. And I must thank, it is my utmost duty to thank Shivam also, who has given us all the support to conduct this program so well. So thank you everybody once again.
Lots of thanks to Dr. Jaydeep Tank. He took out his valuable time, Dr. Surveen Gumman and Shivam. I told him many times to make this correction, that correction, and he always cooperated and did it.
He's very patient. I must appreciate his efforts. So thank you, Ashila ma'am, for giving us this opportunity once again. And all my respected faculty or guests of honor.
And the best thing is this, that we completed in time. We are punctual today.
Yeah. So we can have a photograph.
Yes.
Shivam?
Let me
please switch on the cameras.